And hello, everybody. Today we're going to be talking about the scramble for Africa. So imperialism itself is going to infringe its way into the African continent more than it has ever before. Prior to this time period, we're going to see Africa as a relatively diverse continent. We're going to have different groups throughout Africa with their own languages, their own religions, but mostly they're small tribal groups. We don't see a lot of large empires taking place, and while there's some bigger ones in West Africa or even in South Africa with the Zulus, the majority of the African tribes are going to be small, self-contained political organizations. So, this is going to be this way, though, for like maybe about 800-900 years. There was very little contact with Europeans, except for, you know, the very tops of Egypt when it came to the Mediterranean Sea. They had been in contact with places like Egypt for thousands of years, but for the majority of Africa, it's pretty safe. And it's safe because most of the geography of Africa is pretty harsh to humans. The Sahara Desert is, you know, pretty much the equivalent of hell on Earth. And then you go to the Congo River area, where you have massive jungles and rainforests. We don't have the ability to move up and down rivers as well during this time period, at least prior to this time period. And pretty much everything in Africa is designed to kill you, including mosquitoes, who in Africa would give you malaria or African sleeping sickness, or today we also have like West Nile, something that comes out of this period or this area. And this is going to be a huge contributor as to why Europeans stay out of Africa for a long time. But this is going to change. Things in Africa change, really largely because things in Europe change. Europe is going to modernize, and when it modernizes, it starts to get the key ingredients needed to be able to imperialize Africa and later on Asia. We're going to get vaccines for malaria, thanks to our understanding of germs that comes out of the Second Industrial Revolution. Steamboats are going to be key. First, we use them a lot in North America, but we also realize we can use them in Africa. It's going to dramatically improve our ability to transport up and down rivers. And also, manufacturing processes get cheaper, so guns become cheaper. So guess what? The things that killed us in Africa are now all pretty much not a problem anymore. And this is going to be great for Europeans and awful for Africans. Because the experience in Africa is not generally a great one for everyone. So let's start it off. We're going to break this off into different pieces. First one on our agenda list is going to be North Africa. North Africa is going to be a little bit different than some of the other areas we talk about because they already have some interaction with the Europeans to begin with. When we talk to places of like Libya and Algeria, we're going to see very consistent interaction back and forth. Largely because the Ottoman Empire has lost control of these areas. For hundreds upon hundreds of years, the Ottoman Empire controlled Northern Africa, and Europeans, for the most part, stayed out of it. Well, now as we're approaching the 20th century, the Ottoman Empire is barely holding on to its core pieces back in Turkey, so North Africa is pretty much up for grabs. France is going to take the colony of Algeria and Tunisia. Algeria is going to become an extension of France. It is its most sacred territory, and it is going to fight to it long into the 20th century. Italy is going to take the colony of Libya only after it screws up taking up Ethiopia years before, and we'll talk about that a little bit later. And then there's also going to be the imperial domination of Egypt, but it's not exactly colonization, it's a little bit of a different scenario. So, let's talk about that. Egypt itself is kind of a unique example during this time period because civilization existed in Egypt for thousands upon thousands of years, and they've had direct interaction with Europeans for thousands upon thousands of years. So when we go back to the time of 1900, we have an actual Egyptian economy, an Egyptian people, Egyptian king that is running things because the Ottoman Empire hasn't been around in Egypt for almost 100 years. Since Napoleon invaded Egypt back around 1798, we haven't really seen much of any interaction between the Ottoman Empire and Egypt. So we're going to see the Khedive's dynasty is actually going to attempt to modernize it to the current dynasty that is running Egypt. And they are going to invest a ton of money in doing this. And they make Egypt much more modern than the majority of Africa is. But in order to do this, they have to borrow a ton of money. And they have to allow a lot of European investment in Africa and in Egypt to do this. And what we will see is that we'll see some advantages. Egypt will make a ton of money during the time of the American Civil War due to the fact that cotton becomes extraordinarily expensive without the cotton trade from the South. And Egyptian cotton kind of becomes the key prize cotton area of the world. And even today, like, Egyptian cotton is like the best cotton in the world. Well, we're also going to see the birth of something called the Suez Canal. And this is where Egypt is going to play a major part in this period. The Suez Canal is extraordinarily important. It was originally developed by the French to cut the distance between traveling from Europe to Asia in almost half, because it combined, or at least bridged, the gap between the Mediterranean and the Red Seas. This was a huge engineering feat in Europe. It was something that was absolutely amazing for everyone around, and this is going to be something that's going to attract a lot of attention. But it cost a ton of money to build, and this was money that the Egyptian monarchs had taken out from Europe in loans. Well, an opportunity arises itself, and if there's any country in Europe that's going to take advantage of an opportunity, it's going to be the British. And the British see this as this perfect opportunity. The Prime Minister, Benjamin Disraeli, a guy who you should remember at this point in time, because he's recently been brought up in our class, is going to take advantage of this and offer to the Egypt, hey, we'll buy all of your debt involving the Suez Canal off of you guys. And when they do that, they gain control of the canal. And this is great for Egypt, because they no longer have debt. It's great for Britain, because what country is on the other side of the Red Sea? The greatest colony Britain has in India. This is going to be a dramatic improvement in the amount of time it takes for the British to get goods to and from India, and directly allow them to control India much better than they ever have before. And that's a story we're going to get to in a second, too. Well, this is going to be a huge situation, because the Egyptians originally believed that this is just going to involve, you know, the Suez Canal and nothing else. But eventually, Britain's going to control more and more in Egypt, till eventually they're going to control not only the entire nation of Egypt, but they're effectively going to go after every area around the Nile River. And you can see from this map that anything in red is actually going to become a British territory. Egypt, and then the entire Sudan, we go down to Kenya, Somaliland, and all the way down to South Africa. These areas are all going to go under British control, and the British are going to have the strongest claim to any portion of Africa that we see, because it's the British. And the key to the imperialization of Africa, in many cases, is going to be the ability to bring supplies to Africa. And there isn't a country more equipped to do that than the British. They have the world's largest, most dominant naval empire. So let's go to West Africa. Also, an area from this map that you'll see is controlled by the British. Well, Nigeria is a place that is going to have a huge hotbed of controversy for the British, and really for West Africa in general. It is one of the largest nations in Africa as a whole, but it is completely filled with tons of different peoples. We have the Hausa Fulani, the Igbo, the Yoruba. These are groups that have never had to interact before because they kept their own self-contained kingdoms. Well, the British are going to force them together, and this is one of the key problems that happens throughout African imperialism, and that is that the different European nations never took into account the natural boundaries between groups of people that existed for hundreds of years, and they're going to force a lot of them together, and this is going to create a lot of controversy, it's going to create a lot of violence, and a lot of hatred between these groups who had never had to work together before. While in Nigeria, what we're going to see is that these groups of people do not want to work together, and what they see is this imposing British military coming in and dealing with this. So instead, what the British do is they are going to kind of force the way through Nigeria, control the entire area, and then consolidate it into the Royal Niger Company, which is going to be an actual company that people could take stock into that is Britishly owned, but run independent from the British government. And this is what we call economic imperialism, something we've already kind of tossed around before. These different places where we see economic imperialism are going to have different struggles that they face than, you know, being a direct colony. Because you're dealing with a company which may not have to follow the same rules as a country, and that's going to be pretty significant. Alright, so let's go to Central Africa. Central Africa is a different story entirely because we're not playing with the same people. There's actually an extraordinary story as to the entire foundation of Central African colonization, and many of you guys have probably heard it before, but not really understanding what it has to deal with. And it's a story of Dr. Livingstone. There is a Christian missionary who will go into the heart of Africa, and he begins sending letters out to explore his adventures and how he talks to the different groups of people, and everything goes on. Well, then the story stops. He stops sending letters out and everything disappears, so people are trying to find out what happened to Mr. Livingstone, And they send out a man by the name of Henry Stanley, who's commissioned by the King of Belgium to go find Livingstone. And while he is doing this, the king asks him, will you go ahead and take pictures, but not really pictures, but draw maps, because pictures aren't really a thing at this point in time. So when he does, we find that Central Africa is going to be something that the Dutch are going to have a huge interest in, at least the Belgians are going to have a huge interest in, because there's a lot of opportunities to farm. And the Belgian government is going to create massive plantations under the direct control of King Leopold. And he is going to work the people of Central Africa to death. And you can see from the pictures here, it is not pleasant. If you are caught taking anything, you lose a hand. And these are child laborers. And it becomes so appalling when all of this happens that people are actually going to take power away from the king and no longer allow him to have control over this area of the world. Well, with all this stuff taking place, we're going to start to see someone who really wants to impose some rules as to what's happening. And of course, it's my favorite guy, Otto von Bismarck, is going to step in and be like, you know what, guys, this isn't working. We need to come up with rules as to how we're going to do this whole Africa thing. So they call the Berlin Conference, not coincidentally in Berlin, and the European nations sit down to figure out how to divide Africa. And you can claim an area, and as long as you contain a consistent presence in that area, you have control over it. And this is going to solve a lot of the European problems in the area. Realistically, it had nothing to do with wanting to help Europeans. Bismarck's just doing this to help Germany and give them time so they can actually take part of Africa, which they will do, but they're not consequential portions. But now the Europeans all have their different rules as to how to make this work. And this is happening because we've already talked about this. National power and pride. People are now also seeing this as an opportunity to fulfill that burden that Rudyard Kipling talked about, that white man's burden when we have to improve the native populations. And because of all the advantages that they have, it works really well for them. They have the guns, they have the vaccines, and unfortunately for the African peoples, they don't really get along, so they're even fighting amongst themselves. And this is going to be great for the Europeans because there's tons of raw materials in here. We're going to see diamonds, we're going to see rubber, cocoa. These are great things, but unfortunately not many of them are edible. So we're going to see the African people starve in many places. Some of them will fight back. We will actually see the Zulu tribes become the most organized and really convincing resistance in southern Africa. They will fight back to the British. They will have moments where they beat the British, but unfortunately they can't beat the British entirely. They'll even get help from the Dutch, who will settle in South Africa, who are not okay with the notion of the British controlling them. And despite a great trek that forces the Dutch, also known as the Boers, and the Zulus, away from key pieces of South Africa, what we have is a country that is just destined to have problems. South Africa is littered with diamonds, and what you're seeing here is a diamond mine. The Dutch didn't care. They used South Africa for farming. But the problem is when you mine an area for diamonds, you destroy it ecologically. Nothing can grow there anymore. That's a giant hole in the ground. You aren't finding plants there anymore. So the Dutch and the Zulu are going to fight against the British because they're destroying parts of South Africa in search of diamonds. And we call these the Boer Wars. They're a series of wars that eventually will lead to the British gaining control of South Africa and instituting a policy that we today know as apartheid. Apartheid is going to be a racial classification of South Africa. The white populations are going to get significantly more resources and voting rights, voting abilities than the South African people were. And what we will see is this is a policy that will carry all the way up into the 1990s, when eventually people like Nelson Mandela and Archbishop Desmond Tutu will finally break the hold of apartheid in South Africa. But this is just one of the lasting impacts that takes place in Africa because of imperialism during this time period. Africa itself is going to be reshaped, and not in many ways is it ever good. We're going to see tons of conflict, we're going to see inequality take place, inequality that still exists today, and it's really unfortunate. Alright, last thing we're going to talk about today is a few other resistance movements that take place. Ethiopia is actually the only African nation that fights off the Europeans when it actually thwarts the Italian advance into the country. Their leader, Menelik II, is actually going to pit the British and the Italians against each other and actually get them both to give him a ton of weapons that he uses against the Italians in the Battle of Adowa. It's an impressive victory and signs that, you know, the Africans were able to pull this off. All right, and on that note, folks, thank you guys, and you have a great day.